I'm John Sarlin. Welcome to Nightcap. The markets are closed, but we're still open. First up, another day, another crypto hack. Can crypto ever be secure? Then, it might finally be the end of Congress trading stocks. And last, is J.Crew back after declaring bankruptcy? The chino sellers are hoping so. But first, if it's a day that ends with Y, you can pretty much bet on another crypto heist. And on Tuesday, hackers reportedly stole $190 million worth of crypto from Nomad. It's a bridge provider that allows users to exchange assets between different blockchains. Then, the next day, hackers hit thousands of Solana wallets, reportedly stealing more than $5 million. Two hacks in 2 days. Another black eye for crypto. Let's bring in Molly White, a software engineer who has been called by the Washington Post the crypto world's biggest critic. Molly, I want to ask you about the Nomad hack, which happened recently. It was described as the first decentralized hack. Can you explain what happened?
Yeah, so there was a vulnerability in the smart contracts that power the Nomad bridge. And an attacker was able to exploit that to basically authorize withdrawals to themselves. And because of the nature of the vulnerability, people were able to basically copy what the original attacker had done, replace the destination address with their wallet address, and do exactly the same thing. And so there was sort of this decentralized robbery that happened where everyone was rushing to, you know, go in and claim a share of the vulnerable funds that were in the bridge, which amounted to around $190 million.
I saw people tweeting the photo of like the Brinks truck falling on the highway. I thought that was pretty apt. It was pretty wild.
Yeah, absolutely.
I want to ask you about regulation. Obviously, there's been a lot of talk about regulation in crypto. There's a new bill this week that we've learned about that would give the CFTC power to oversee crypto. Do you think that this, the hacks that we're seeing all of the time, do you think this is a problem that can be regulated away?
I think that consumer protections are something that we're going to need to see more of in crypto regulation. And so, you know, I don't know if there is a regulatory answer to some of the vulnerabilities and code issues that we're seeing in crypto, although, you know, there could be requirements for code auditing and things like that that we see in critical systems. But I do think that, you know, giving some consumer protections and requiring some responsibility from the crypto exchanges and other platforms that have become vulnerable is going to be essential.
Well, I want to ask you about the code vulnerabilities. You're a software engineer. You understand how blockchain works. And I want to ask you about the kind of inherent contradiction when it comes to crypto, because when it really is decentralized, right, it's slow and it's expensive. And so you need these kind of centralized exchanges to spring up, which opens the doors for hacks like we're seeing possible. Is this a problem that can be solved?
I think no matter what, there are going to be issues with crypto platforms that are caused by the fact that they're relying on blockchains. You know, the actual central piece of this technology makes it very difficult to write code that you can trust will never have a bug. And that's sort of what you need to do in these cases. You know, I think most software engineers understand that bugs are pretty inevitable. And that a system in which it's very difficult to patch bugs and the consequences of having a bug are absolutely catastrophic, is not a great system.
Yeah, it's one thing if you have a bug and like your software doesn't work. It's another thing if there's a bug and then you lose your entire life savings.
Exactly.
Seems like a bad bug. Molly, well, thank you for coming on.
Thanks for having me.
Next up, members of Congress trading stocks. The public doesn't want it. According to a Fox News poll, 70% of those asked want to ban it, and yet it still happens, even after the Stock Act passed in 2012, which required disclosures around trades. Scandals are still popping up. Business Insider has kept a running list of members who have failed to properly report their financial trades. It's currently at 67 members. And in December, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi was asked if members of Congress should be banned from trading stocks. She said no.
This is a free market and people, we have a free market economy. They should be able to participate in that.
Now, 2 months later, Speaker Pelosi changed her stance. And now a source tells CNN that House Democratic leadership will soon announce legislation that would ban lawmakers, their spouses, and senior staff from trading stocks. Here to weigh in is Liz Hempowicz, Director of Public Policy at the Project on Government Oversight. Liz, thanks for coming on.
Happy to be here.
So Liz, you testified in front of Congress that members trading stocks is, quote, disastrous for public faith in the institution of Congress. Can you explain why?
Yeah, you know, I think it's really important to keep in mind, first and foremost, that members of Congress hold seats of public trust. They're in Washington, D.C. because their constituents have elected them to do their will in D.C. And so with stock trading and with members owning stock and having no restrictions whatsoever, what they can own and what they can sell and when they could do it, it's created a really obvious opportunity for self-dealing. And the public has weighed in forcefully, loudly. You were talking about the poll results, that they do not want to see this happening anymore. And so I think, you know, kind of even beyond when I was testifying about the issue itself, now we have something that is a compounded problem. The public has seen that there's a problem. They have asked Congress now to address it. And if we don't see Congress address it, it's not just going to be the initial problem. It's going to be that Congress failed to appropriately meet the moment. And I think the public's going to be even more concerned, lose even more trust and faith in the institution.
Well, let's talk about the proposal. So word came out recently about a new plan in Congress to potentially ban it. We haven't seen the specifics yet, but it would reportedly force lawmakers, their spouses, and their senior staff to either put their stocks in a blind trust or to completely divest. Do you think that would go far enough?
Yes, I think, you know, from those bullet points, yes. But I think the devil's in the details here. And I think the fact that we still don't have a bill, a consensus bill, either in the House or Senate, when there have been working groups working in both chambers for months now to address a problem that has been really obvious for years, I think that is a real cause for concern. You know, I think that the specifics you just highlighted are exactly what we'd like to see. But I would really like to know why we haven't seen that yet. None of that is new. That those proposals are included in legislation that has been in front of this Congress almost since day one when the Congress began in January 2021. What is the holdup? We really need leadership to step up and take control of the situation and make it clear that Congress cannot close out this year without passing legislation that addresses this issue.
So let's talk about one detail, which was about spouses and trading. So Nancy Pelosi has gotten a lot of criticism for her husband's stock trades. And there's a debate, right, about whether the ban should include spouses. This is from the Punchbowl report. Some sources have suggested that the inclusion of spouses is unnecessarily onerous. For example, what happens if a member of Congress's spouse is a stockbroker? Does he or she have to quit their job? So, Liz, do you think it's fair to ban spouses from trading stocks?
I want to address that specific point because I think it's a really good example of how the conversation around this has been muddied unintentionally and unnecessarily. To that specific example of a member's spouse as a stockbroker, they are exempted. If their job is to trade stocks, that is not what we're talking about. What we are talking about are the stocks that they personally own, individual stocks, right? Not mutual funds, not diversified funds. But thank you for the opportunity to address that. That question and questions like that have really been getting under my skin because it is really clear in the proposals out there how that would be addressed. And I think the fact that those talking points keep coming up just go to show me that there are some people out there that are trying to make this more complicated than it needs to be. But to your point, to your direct question about spouses and children, it is no question that they have to be included in this. And why do they need to be included? Because it could be a very obvious, opaque loophole that would allow somebody to exploit any new restriction that go in place if they just work through their spouse. The public can see right through that. And to the extent that this is about addressing a clear concern from the public, spouses, children must be included. The end.
So details TBD. When we do get them, Liz, we'd love to have you on to go through them one by one. And last up, is J.Crew back? It's a question the chino wearing among us are asking. Now, there was a time when J.Crew was the essential outfit of the urban professional type, but times change and J.Crew did not. Thanks to things like the rise of streetwear and a global pandemic closing offices, J.Crew declared bankruptcy in 2020. But it's back. Maybe. They've hired a new CEO, a new flashy designer, and are now launching their new collection. But is it enough to raise the cashmere and khaki company back from the dead? To answer that question, we have on James Harris and Lawrence Schlossman, the hosts of Throwing Fits, a menswear podcast. James and Lawrence, thanks for coming on.
What's up, John?
How are you?
I'm good. I hope my fit doesn't get roasted by you two, but, you know.
Unclear.
TBD.
So they've hired a new designer who's like a very hip menswear designer. He has this brand called Noah. They're clearly aiming to make people like you interested in J. Crew. So I guess I'll ask you, did it work? Is J. Crew back?
I mean, we're talking about it, but that being said, this guy, Brendan Babenzien, even before Noah, he was at Supreme, arguably the biggest and most important streetwear brand in the world. And yeah, it's been one season. I think there's been some splashy press and rollout, but the images we're looking at are maybe trying to get guys like who listen to Throwing Fits or guys like myself and Lawrence to wear it, but they're still very much just like basic office wear, you know, stuff your girlfriend or wife buys for you.
Yeah, they definitely doubled down on the prep heritage, which makes sense in terms of like the connective DNA that has existed from jump when they launched as a catalog business in the early 80s. But yeah, like James said, it's a little early. I'm not sure there's anything here that really jumps out at me. And if you look on the website, the price points are creeping up. So while there needs to be some type of middle ground entry level brands for young professionals to like get cool clothes, I'm not sure if they have nailed it just yet.
What does it take to revive a brand? I mean, they're clearly kind of going for the tastemakers, right? They're selling $800 shoes. Do you think it makes sense for them to go to try to get some, you know, some kind of the influencers interested in it? Or should they be aiming at the people walking around the malls, whichever malls do exist, and walking by a J. Crew?
Yeah, it's a gargantuan task, you know, to say the least. And I think that when you try to be everything to everyone, you end up being nothing. And them straddling the line currently, despite the fact that we are talking about them, despite the fact that there's this nuclear press moment happening, they haven't really figured it out. And I think eventually they're going to have to figure out which side of the fence they want to be on. Do you want to go after the cool guys and have a trickle-down effect? Or do you want to have a guy walking from the food court just pop in and buy a bunch of sweaters? And yeah, it's going to be tough to do both of those things. But if anyone can figure it out, it's Brendan. His track record and his personal taste level is stellar. So, you know, Hopefully the best is yet to come.
Yeah. And maybe we're wrong. Maybe, you know, you go see Thor and IMAX and get your Panda Express and then go buy a $400 Italian suede leather vest. Could be wrong. I don't know.
The vest did look nice. Okay. Let me ask you this, which has been, you know, it's not just J.Crew, right? It's been a rough few years for a lot of traditional retailers. Do you think there are other brands that, you know, might be coming back like J.Crew might be right now?
I mean, you've like Gap was in the headlines for, you know, partnering up with Kanye on its, you know, Gap Yeezy and Balenciaga with Demna. But it's so, I guess what kind of baffles us is why exactly there's such a enthusiasm from like larger stakeholders to revive these like more traditional American mall brands. And the answer is definitely just like the infrastructure is already in place. I mean, there's hundreds of Gap stores across the country, dozens of J.Crew stores across the country. You know, so I think it's about turning a profit for sure. But I don't think that anyone's really successfully done it yet.
Yeah.
Whether it's Gap, Club Monaco, J.Crew,
Abercrombie. Yeah. I think guys like James and I are much more interested in, you know, taking some of the resources that would go to be reviving these kind of dinosaurs, for lack of a better term, and maybe funding young upstart designers with, you know, really specific and personal point of views and voices when it comes to clothing, specifically men's clothing. Obviously, like James said, infrastructure and logistics, like, you know, definitely prevent that. And at the end of the day, it's about the bottom line. But in terms of our personal interest in bringing back these older brands, you know, we kind of watch it from the sidelines. We're not going to be, and we're going to be talking about it to be clear, but we're not necessarily going to be walking into the stores and spending our own hard-earned money.
If Nancy Pelosi's husband starts investing, maybe I'll throw in a few bucks, because he knows what's up.
But he's got a great track record.
Lawrence and James, thanks for coming on. The podcast is throwing fits. Don't forget to subscribe. Thank you, guys. And that's all from us. Don't forget to sign up for our Nightcap newsletter at cnn.com/nightcap. And join us again next week at 4 p.m. Eastern right here at CNN Business.